Okay, good evening, everybody. Good evening, councillors. Our last meeting before Christmas. Can I also extend a very warm welcome to our members of the public who are here tonight. You enjoyed the meeting and take a very full part in it, but not too noisy, if that's okay with you. So, the next item I deal with is declarations of interest. Are there any declarations of interest? Matters we're discussing. No? Okay. Okay, I've been notified of the following apologies. Councillor Pat Williams, who, can I just say, I have sent a card, a get well card, so I hope she picks up notice of an operation on the foot. And I've received apologies from Sherry Ogle. Are there any other apologies? There aren't any. Okay. So, under Mayor's announcements, carrying on, can I invite Councillor Norbury to just address the Council regarding the members' development charter awarded from North West Employers? Thank you, Tony.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd just like to present the members' development charter that all councillors took part in the training. I'm very privileged to go up to the North West Employers and receive this on behalf of the Council and my peers within the Council who have helped us develop our members' training throughout the years, really. This is a wall that we've built up to as elected members, and it's very, very important that all elected members take part in the development training of us ourselves as members. As we move forward in the Council, I know how important it is that we take this Council forward and we have the right skills to be able to engage with our people and to develop our areas where it's our services that we're delivering to our people. So I'd just like to congratulate everyone really on behalf of the North West Employers and on behalf of the organisational development team who took part in this award and helped us to take part in the training and to achieve this. So I think we're going to leave it on one of the tables outside so everyone can have a look at it. So I'd just like to congratulate everyone across the four parties who helped us to achieve the North West Development Charter for elected members. Thank you.
Okay, the only other announcement and another bit of good news is to congratulate everyone involved at the Floor of the Pavilion as we maintain and receive again our National Green Tourism Award for that great facility. So I think that deserves a round of applause as well. Are there any petitions that councillors wish to present to council tonight? Yeah, Trina?
Yeah.
Yeah. Jerry? There's only you two, yeah, okay. Trina?
I've got a petition. Please move your petition in 5 minutes.
signed by local authorities and the local government workforce at the Brighton. We have taken more than our share of the pain and the cutbacks, with nearly half a million jobs being lost already. Whilst the bulk of these jobs have been through redundancy freezes, early retirement, voluntary redundancies, every single job cut is a wage loss. Wirral Council is one of the largest employers in the rural area. Many of its workforce live in this area. As a result, they spend their money in this area. Money spent within our community, using local shops and purchasing services for local businessmen. They have a direct effect on the wider economy of the Wirral. Any reduction in that spending power will be felt over by the shops and businesses in this area. Cutbacks, job losses, and pay cuts. One area of the local economy will have a direct effect on other areas of the local economy, creating further cutbacks and job losses in our local shops and local businesses. Rural council jobs are a major part of the local economy. The reduction and removal of council services will only create an ever-increasing disadvantaged community, causing further hardship to the public and especially damaging those members of the public on low incomes who rely on the services that the council has been providing. Year after year of cutbacks to our council's finances, over £150 million in the last 5 years, has caused massive damage to our local economy. The UK economy has grown by only half the amount predicted in the June 2000 spending review, and the government is due to borrow £161 million more in 2014-15 than originally planned. By 2015-16, £375 billion will have been cut from public spending. This will rise to a cost of £67.8 billion by 2018-19, with the slow recovery means the government has had to extend its austerity programme by 3 years. Only 605 public service jobs have been called since the coalition government came to power. Fair plan company at the top number of job losses is projected to rise to 1.1 million. By 2018, unless there is a change in policy. Yet, corporation tax for the biggest companies, those profits above 1.5 billion, have been cut every year from 28% in 2010 to 21% in 2014-15. The Commission wants this to fall to 20% in 2015-16, meaning those big companies will pay £7.1 billion less in taxes in 2015-16 than they did in 2010-11. People earning over £150,000 a year have received a tax cut. Paul Krugman, a US economist and Nobel Prize winner, said that the British budget and the rhetoric that accompanied it might have come straight from the desk of Andrew Mellon, Treasury Secretary to President Hoover, to fight the depression by liquidating the farmers, liquidating the workers, and driving down wages. Or if you prefer, British precedents, it echoes the Snowy budget of 1931. Tries to restore confidence but ended up deeper in the economic crisis. The British government's plan is bold and closing goes in exactly the wrong direction. It would cut government employment at the time in the private sector and in no conditions provide alternative employment. It would slash spending at the time when private demand isn't all ready to take up the slack. Why is the British government doing this, he asked. The real reason has a lot to do with ideology. The Tories use the deficit as an excuse outside the state, but the official rationale is that there is no alternative. I'll quote Sue Kellett, a professor of economics at Yorkshire University and a member of the UK Women's Budget. The biggest overall cut is in local government. Local government provides many essential personal services that women and their families need. Women in the ones who will likely make up the shortfall in these services by their own unpaid efforts in the home. In some cases, their own employment and income to make that possible. Women are 68% of those employed by local authorities, so this contributes to impact disproportionately on women's employment decisions. Danny Grantfire, former member of the Bank of England Monetary Policy Committee, this is the biggest and riskiest macro experiment undertaken by any advanced country in living memory. A Harvard economist said that no government unless forced to would be dug in to make such unnecessary risk. The well-being of the nation. Every country will be watching to ensure they don't receive the same mistake as your job for blindly unnecessary misguided, doctrinaire, and potentially dangerous spending cuts. Cuts are not the cure. They are political choices, not granted by greedy banks, created by greedy banks and financial speculators, is huge damage to our economy. These deep rapid cuts are not the best way to solve our problem. They are a false economy. We don't want to go back to the 1930s. We look ahead. We want to look ahead and work towards a brighter future. This is not an unreasonable expectation for people to have. This is an expectation anyone living in a modern democratic state should aspire to. Austerity is not working. It's not working in the UK. It's not working in the north of England. And it's clearly not working in Wirral. Austerity gives support on those who know who they're taking the hardest. The current rollout of the Council of Services, has shown UNISON members that it's not known if the board shows it's suffering the most weight. The pay reduction that they proposed to Wirral Council staff, I hit those staff here, though UK have been paying the most. We note and welcome the recent changes to our digital pay policy. But we have examples for staff here currently earn £19,500 and face a pay cut of £3,400 a year, a reduction of over 17%. For a staff of £21,992, we face a potential pay cut of £4,792, a reduction of over 21%. At the same time, we see the postal chief executives receive a very healthy pay rise. This is not an example of voters of the board to show that they taking the most weight. Now more than ever, we need Wirral Council Security Services and protect the staff that provides them. The members of Wirral UNISON and many members of the public who signed our petition want to know what the Council has done to get the message to the coalition government that austerity is not working and local authorities need better, improved and fairer funding. Thanks for listening.
Mr. Mayor, my only concern
concern about this resolution is the first line, frankly, that talks about stopping the cuts. Because whilst every fibre in my body agrees with that in spirit, the reality is we are the administration and we have to make books balance. And it is a terrible position to be in, but that is the reality of the party that controls council in the north. And that applies not just to the north, but to many other councils in the north of England. So I think it's not going to be possible to support this resolution because of that first line. But the rest of it, I think we are totally in support of. And can I just, in closing, say, but one thing is absolutely clear. If we have 5 more years of austerity, then I genuinely believe it will be the end of the world for government. I think it's that start, a choice. We have tried everything we can to lobby this government to reverse the disastrous austerity policies, but it's very clear that they're not listening. Mr. Mayor, next May, the people of Wirral and the rest of the UK have an opportunity to change that situation and to consign this short-term, compassionless government to history. I'm confident they'll take it. Thank you, Mr. Lindsay.
Money have they got in the pockets?
Mr. Mayor, the ECHO report on the 11th of December, the Wirral is one of the most prolific areas in the UK to start firms since the recession. There are 12,819 businesses in Wirral. 66% have started on or after the 1st of September 2008. Nearly 18% of those are in professional scientific or technical area. And indeed, our Director of Regeneration, it was mentioned the Wirral's GVA has been by 7%, which is the highest in the north of England. So there are, no doubt about it, austerity has been difficult. It's been difficult for each and every person that has been touched by or had to contend with some of the really difficult measures that the coalition government had to take. But I would just point out, Mr. Mayor, that within that there are choices that can be made. And I think the last council I was explaining that yes, the government has set a much tighter, more difficult financial envelope for the council to operate in. But within that financial envelope, it is the council and the administration that have made those particular choices. And let us be clear, even at the last council, when we pointed out in terms of how scandalous it was, that at the same time, the choice that had been made by the administration was to cut pay for some of the lowest paid workers in the council and to pay $175,000 a year for the chief executive, that was just wrong. actually reverse that decision and to make a U-turn on that decision, because it clearly, as Mr. Goodwin pointed out, it is clearly, in the current circumstances, absolutely unjustifiable. And I did think, and along with your Labour Party colleagues, that you will actually take the opportunity, you can do it at the last council meeting, but you have a further opportunity to think again and to change that decision, because it is just simply plain wrong and unfair.
I'm actually just making a question. I hear a democracy.
Let him speak.
Sit down and I'll run the meeting. Thanks very much, those in the gallery.
I was going to propose, Mr. Mayor, that we thank Phil Goodwin for his very compelling presentation of the petition, and that we note the petition and representation there of our movements.
Mayor, I have got standing orders in front of me, and no doubt would be advised. But if there was to be a proportional debate that reflects the views of the parties, then an opportunity might be given to Patrick Fleming. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
Let's tax it, let's redistribute, let's end austerity.
that changes.
Oh,
moving on. We now move on to public questions. So we've got a seconder for Councillor Davidson for both of that. We note this and it'll be used there to inform debate in the next item of debate. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, thank you for that. Moving on, we have a public question. Oh, sorry, not a petition. We have another petition that has been withdrawn, which is B2, which was the issues around the Rural Savings Centre as events have overtaken us. So that's been withdrawn. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Right, moving on. Thank you, Councillor Smith. That's promptly there. Moving on, we now have a public question to Councillor Tony Smith by Mr. John Brace.
Earlier this year, the first decision about it at school made by Cabinet on the 16th of January was called in.
item 5 now, which is leaders, executives and members and chairs reports. Members will recall we had this session at the last meeting. Those reports are still in the possession of members. I think, in reality, there's no need to continue this item other than move on. Is that noted?
Yeah.
Is that agreed? So we now move on to matters requiring approval by council. Councillors should turn to page 6, item 6, pages 5 to 28 of the agenda, which includes recommendations from Cabinet for the 9th of December 2014, decision of Deputy Leader of the Council, 15th December 2014. Firstly, item A on the Council summons, page 3 to 17, which is A1, which is 9th of December 2014, Council Budget Consultation Command. Notice of the agreement of amendments to the Standing Order 12, Package 9, which is included in the supplementary agenda. First of all, I call on to formally move the mover of the recommendation. And formally second. And mover, proposer, sorry, for the amendment. Yeah, the other Council Gilchrist. And the second is Council Rickhouse. Thank you. Okay. Councillor Davis, you will have 7 minutes to move and speak to your recommendation, and then I will call Councillor Gilchrist to formally move his amendment. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I move the Cabinet's resolution on the budget options. Mr. Mayor, this Council faces a fifth consecutive year of savage cuts in our budget by a government and a Chancellor, which is pursuing, as I said earlier, an extreme ideological agenda of taking Britain back the 1930s spending levels, which existed well before we had the National Health Service and when children left school at 14. The impact of austerity on rural residents is reflected in £151 million worth of cuts. This council has had to suffer since 2010, forcing us to make almost impossible decisions about which services are most deserving of continued support. Mr. Mayor, the truth is that all of our public services are important, and this Tory-led government's ideology, which to their eternal shame the Democrats have supported, has meant that households in the 10 most deprived local authorities in England will face a reduction in spending power per household 16 times greater than the least deprived. And Mr. Mayor, let's have no crocodile tears tonight from the party's opposites about how terrible these cuts are and we're being forced to make. Let's be clear, the responsibility lies squarely at the door of this discredited coalition government. Mr. Mayor, instead of complaining, the party's opposite should be apologising for the actions of their ministers. Mr. Mayor, against this backdrop, I am proud that this Labour administration has brought this council's budget under control, having inherited an overspend from the last Tory Lib Dem administration of £17 million. We've given priority to protecting frontline services and reducing the cost of bureaucracy. We do believe that the broader shoulders should bear the largest burden, and we've taken £5 million out of the cost of senior management. While further changes in the management structure are on hold pending the appointment of a new chief exec, we are committed to delivering further savings of £1.5 million senior management costs. Mr. Mayor, we've delivered our corporate priorities through investing in new house building, apprenticeships, the Reach Out programme, which gets long-term unemployed people back to work, and a selective licensing pilot scheme to improve standards in the private rented housing sector. And I am proud that Wirral, under this Labour administration, was one of the first living wage councils in this country. And we're now working towards Wirral becoming a living wage borough. This brings me to our savings proposals, recommendations 15 and 16. Once again, we have applied the principles I've just outlined to identify how we achieve the £18 million gap due to government cuts. £15.5 million of this gap will be met through internal efficiencies and the income from acceptance of the council tax freeze grant. Mr. Mayor, let me make it clear again that although we are not setting next year's budget this evening, It is my intention to propose to council that we freeze the council tax for a further year. Mr. Mayor, council tax bills are often the largest bills which households face, and I believe that another year's freeze will be widely welcomed by the people of Wirral. Mr. Mayor, I find it amazing that some political parties, such as the Green Party and Brighton, are arguing for council tax increases of up to 6%, which will hit clearly the poorest, the hardest, and waste precious resources on conducting the referendum. And if that's the choice that Councillor Cleary wants to make for rural residents, I'm pretty sure what response he will get. Mr. Mayor, let me turn now to the Chief Exec's budget options, about which we consulted earlier in the year. Can I say, first of all, how pleased I am at almost 8,000 respondents taking part in this consultation, one of the highest levels of engagement of any area of the country. And I'd like to record my sincere thanks to all those who took part in the consultation and sent in letters, petitions, etc. I want to talk first about the savings we will not be making. Mr. Mayor, the Youth and Play Service provides a valued service to many young people and families. The proposal would have meant closing our satellite youth clubs and the number of play schemes. There was significant opposition to this from users and the public generally, and we will not be making this saving. Similarly, there was overwhelming opposition to charging for parking in our countryside parks. We wish to ensure that these remain accessible to everyone. Therefore, we will not be supporting this saving. With regard to closing the remaining council run public conveniences, whilst there may be an argument for asking businesses and others to take over responsibility for providing these services at some point in the future, the alternatives are not in place at present. We will therefore not be making this saving. The removal of council funding for school crossing controls in the 47 sites which have puffin or pelican crossings was considered, and whilst a majority of respondents to the consultation supported this option, we are not prepared to support this in advance of full risk assessments, and therefore will not be making this saving. With regard to roadside grip bins, charging for establishing cold calling zones and pest control, we believe that these cuts would impact most severely on people living in private communities, and will therefore not be making these savings. With regard to two budget options, community guidelines and preventative maintenance, we're recommending that saving be reduced substantially for the original budget option published by the Chief Exec. In terms of preventative maintenance, this will enable us to continue to carry out emergency work to our highways and maintain levels of safety. For our community libraries, by reducing the saving from 411,000 to 190,000, we will be able to open the 15 community libraries for 18 hours per week rather than 10 hours, and we will work with friends groups and others to extend these hours where possible. I will also perhaps emphasise the opening hours of four largest central libraries and four merged library one-stop shops will remain as at present. Mr. Mayor, I'm proud that unlike many other councils, no libraries will close in the next year. And when we have a more enlightened government which believes in investing in public services, we will be able to build the opening of hours up once again. Mr. Mayor, the budget option we are recommending for approval are those with the largest levels of public support and set out on page 16 of the supplementary agenda. They add up to 2.4 million, which takes account of the additional £100,000 saving in 15-16 arising from the extension of the LIFT contract for refuse disposal agreed in Cabinet last week. Mr. Mayor, I'm disappointed that we're being forced to remove the over 17th council tax discount. We're almost the only authority in the country which offered such a discount. An important mitigating fact is that the discount was not based on individuals' personal and financial circumstances, and the vast majority of our poorest pensioners do not pay any council tax. And with regard to the saving tax for West Kirby Green Lake, about which we heard earlier on, I'm able to advise council that we will not be transferring the management of this asset to another organisation. The existing team is confident that they will be able to deliver this saving, and they are working on a business plan to achieve this. In conclusion, Mr. Mayor, I believe that we have done the best we can to mitigate the impact of government cuts. More detail will follow in the new year when we receive government final settlements and key information such as our levies and precepts. But I conclude by making a simple plea.
a further 5 years of austerity, which hits the poorest areas the hardest, will, I believe, as I said earlier, be the end of local government, as we know it, in regions like Merseyside. I appeal to all members of all political parties to convey to their national leaders the importance of investing in local government and resisting the temptation to pursue more of the same. I so move.
Then requires a subsidy from the rest of the youth service budget. roads into the hubs and other clubs, then that would be an unwise course for this council. Turning now to highways maintenance and parks maintenance. In the report, in the report that the committee received, the regeneration committee, quote, members were surprised that the small scale of the park's BPM budget had concerns about this being further reduced, highlighting the need for Wirral's park to remain safe and usable both the short and long term. Understand, I see, that some concession, some reinstatement has been made, but I want to turn to highways. As most recently, the scrutiny committee looked at the comparison of spending on highway maintenance in recent years. They were grateful that in this year, 2014-15, the government has given £1.1 million towards road maintenance to add to, and it's called other grants to report, but it came from the government. The road maintenance, I've been saying for some time, needs some consistent funding, which brings me to money, Mr. Mayor. This year, the council has substantial capital receipts, and I believe there is scope for some work on using those in a more effective way. And I believe that if officers and members have a mind to do that, they can actually have some investment in our road highway network. Finally, a lot has been said about the coalition and council. I look to Cheshire West's budget papers. They talk about severe changes for Cheshire West being in line with those experienced by the council. They started to set a budget in October. That's a quote from their officer's report. But I've also been reading this again, and this is the latest version. I've examined the zero-based review for local government. I entirely see in it what we've been talking about earlier, the issue of the debt that I mentioned, or the 5 years that the leader has mentioned. In that, it's clear that there will be savings, there will be continued reduction in the deficit, there will be things that change. And a lot of the Labour zero-based review does indeed flow from what the Adonis report and all the other documents we've seen about taking other layers of government out, even the Chief of the London Police talked about that for the last day or so. So the intention is to find savings in that, which of course means jobs and organisations elsewhere. As far as I see from what it says, that document, the zero-based one, expects local government to follow the best practice of other areas. And it talks about shared services, Mr. Mayor. And for those of us who had a lot of thought about shared services a year or so ago, there may be savings in that. But Mr. Mayor, I commend my amendment to the council, particularly I hope members have worked through it. I hope it gets support from a number of members.
Thanks, Councillor Gilchrist. I will take speakers. I've got four. I will take those four. Just five. So let me get with that. Okay. Right. I'm going to take Trina Johnson first. I've been informed that this would be her maiden speech, so I think. Well, I'm sitting there nervously, Trina, and I'll let you get it out of the way, okay?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm delighted that the Labour Cabinet has listened to the voice of Wirral residents and protected Wirral's excellent and valued youth pay services. Why? First, because it allows me to record a big drink in my maiden speech, which has been good, but more seriously, because youth pay provision offer three clear advantages for our community and nation as a whole. So what do they offer? Youth clubs and play schemes have long been the bedrock of our society, and having two teenage sons risen there, I only know too well that these facilities are vital for our children. Young people need to understand the world around them and where they fit into the world. Youth clubs and play schemes introduce young people to the rigours of Duke of Edinburgh's award qualifications. Second, they organise clips and workshop facilities for young people, which keeps them off the streets. For example, in my ward, we have Pizza Adventure Playground involving 300 plus children. They organise trips to places like Blackpool, Deeside Ice Rink and Chester Zoo. They are the only scheme in Wallasey to host a community bonfire with more than 400 children attending each year. And in Morton, we club are on antisocial behaviour events for 13 to 19 year olds on a Friday evening with Wirral UK Tire Fundover hosting free self-defence classes. And we do hope to do more, Mr. Mayor, with not-for-profit organisations that will benefit our young people and give them something that they can feel infused and encouraged by. Third, moving on from play activity to training for the world of work. Youth work offers young people skills that they can take through life, which is not the same as getting good grades. Youth unemployment remains a persistently worrying problem, with almost 1 million young people out of work. Our priority must be vocational education and a career service to which all young people have access, and of course, apprenticeships. Having won a local victory on the provision of youth and play services, our next target should be a reform of national public policy to allow for apprenticeships to become compulsory, with small firms being supported to offer apprenticeships, like those previously provided national schemes, which offered high quality apprenticeships. That's what our youth need. I know that Wirral Council has a successful apprenticeship programme that has helped more than 500 youths begin their careers, which is something we can be proud of in Wirral. Something that this out of touch Tory-led government should be implementing, not exploitation, 0 hours contracts. So with antisocial behaviour on the increase and youth unemployment at all-time high, we need more youth clubs and play schemes, not less. And while I understand the current financial climate that we are in at the moment, this decision by cabinet will now allow the youth clubs and play schemes to have the time to look into working alongside interested community, voluntary and faith groups in order to sustain these vital services for the future of our children. I'm proud that our Labour Party has stood that and welcome that the commitment to protect youth and play services in this budget.
Increase the pay of the chief executive to
a shame.
Okay, I'm not going to call any more speakers. I've got all the ones who've indicated it. I'm trying to mix it up a little bit in terms of party. So I'll go to Stuart as a member.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Councillor Johnson made a speech, she's made some excellent points.
And they pontificate, and they call us morally bankrupt. We've lost the unilateral contracts where people go, they're not given any kind of guaranteed contract, they can't budget, they can't get a mortgage, they can't pay the bills half the time, they have to sit by a phone and wait for a text all day. We've got low pay, which is rampant, and public sector workers are losing, and there's more to come, more job cuts to come for public sector workers. We've got in-work poverty. We've got more people who have to rely on benefits that are actually earning a wage. Do you remember him saying, I'll cut the deficit, not the NHS? But he's a barefaced liar and we all know it now. I just want to add my support to Phil Davis and everything this Labour group are doing. It's been really, really difficult for us. No one came into office to do what we're having to do. But let's just remind ourselves where the blame lies and let's not stand for any more of this hypocrisy.
Sue Kellett of UNISON, and concluded that this authority was in breach of its his speech to the Wirral Library Festival, Councillor David promised a meaningful consultation which would take place with each individual library user group. In fact, it emerged in a cabinet report some time later. To my knowledge, this hasn't happened. Those individual library groups are still waiting. So how can this council endorse reducing opening hours when no consultation with these individuals has taken place? Yet again, we are laying ourselves open to legal challenge. And secondly, Mr. Mayor, the Public Libraries and Museums Act, amongst other statutory duties, actually places a duty on this authority to encourage adults and children to make full use of library services. By drastically reducing the opening hours without a comprehensive plan in place, we actively discourage library users with its haphazard opening hours. And the third point I'd like to make, Mr. Mayor, is the equality impact assessment that was done is out of date. It was done last March and still actually has a draft on it. There's been no mitigation mentioned in it. And it states, and I quote, inconsistency in opening times creates confusion and reluctance to return to site. It goes on further to say there is a significant impact on younger members of the community and after school children will not be able to visit a library in their community. Mr. Mayor, again, this is evidence enough to conclude that Cabinet's AC recommendations in all likelihood may breach the Act. And quite frankly, I am bewildered that with all the history and baggage that this issue evokes, no comprehensive action plan is in place to ensure that all members of the community are able to access a library within reasonable timescales. Quite frankly, Cabinet should be embarrassed that they're repeating the same mistake. Talk about ignorance for that. Mr. Mayor, it's actually my opinion that this council budget proposal pertaining to libraries certainly falls foul of the Charter's recommendations and in all likelihood breaches their statutory duties as a library authority. Let's not make the same mistake of the past. Let's pause. Let's come up with a comprehensive library strategy to ensure that all users are able to access a library. And let's not lead this council down a path of yet another inquiry or damning report.
Bonuses great job for young people and scrapping their bedroom tax.
Yes!
That's the difference between us and them. That's why on the next May, the Labour government plans to take £30 billion from Whitehall over 5 years and pass it to local councils, to northern regions like ours, so we have the means to create jobs and further investment. It will be, Mr. Mayor, the biggest economic decentralisation in the century. Better choices, different choices, Labour choices, not your choices. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Big House. Can I call on the seconder of the standing
of democracy. Mr. Mayor, we know that our deprived communities would be hardest hit by proposals such as reduction in youth and play services. And we, in keeping with the public views, and importantly, the views of the service users themselves, children across the borough who contributed to the consultation exercise, their parents and our employees have rejected this proposal, as we have done with the proposal regarding school crossing patrols, demonstrating our commitment to the safety and well-being of our young people. On the matter of young people, Mr. Mayor, we are also committed to continuing with an apprenticeship programme, giving our young people the opportunity to develop real skills to take them into the world of work. These matters address all three of our corporate priorities: protecting our vulnerable young people by ensuring that they are safe and have play and diversionary and educational opportunities, and helping them to be work ready for future jobs in the borough. What we do know, Mr. Mayor, is that those services and options for cuts which we have not taken are not statutory, and will always be vulnerable in any future budget setting process. That is why we want our officers to bring forward real transformational change models of service delivery going forward to ensure that we find creative ways of working to secure the future of those services and developing partnerships and working with our other public service partners. We are proud of the fact, Mr. Mayor, that we have 24 libraries, none of them subject to closure, but finding alternative ways of working and hopefully developing work with friends and volunteers to expand their offer is going to be key and a priority. At the outset, Mr. Mayor, I set out those letters which are hurting people. It's a shameful legacy for any political party to be associated with, and it would be to their credit if any of those opposition elected members in this chamber were to personally condemn the horrendous policies and cuts of their government. It's that which is worse than petty and vindictive, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, I am delighted to commend the Labour Budget to Council and urge all members. Mr. Mayor,
the Liberal Democrats have said, well, do we have to keep coming back with these budgets? Well, yes, as long as your government, that you're supporting, keeps on cutting our budget, we've got no alternative but to keep coming back with these options. Get your ministers to change direction, and we won't need to make mistakes. And I really thank Councillor Brickhouse for his suggestions that we don't need all our grip bins, and I'll be writing it to him tomorrow to point out to me which grip bins he thinks we can get rid of. So I welcome every suggestion for a saving. In terms of the issues that Stuart Kelly made up, first of all, it's not Birkenhead UNISON, it's Wirral UNISON, it's a UNISON for the whole of Wirral. And we made very clear that it will serve the young people in the whole of Wirral. And we will make sure the youth, our other youth clubs, remain open until people vote with their feet. And if they vote with their feet, then the Wirral UNISON will gain popularity. But until then, we will keep our youth, the youth clubs, open as far as they can. On the issue of the libraries, we do have a plan for the 18 hours. That plan is in place. It gives a core 18 hour sort of offer to residents, but it also maintains the additional hours, the 48 hours that our central libraries and our one-stop shop libraries offer. Now, within that core offer, there is scope for working with friends groups and others to extend those 18 hours, and I would certainly be very, very happy if through constituency committees we had that debate about how we can extend that 18-hour offer. So it's not a one-size-fits-all model. It is a model that is capable of some fine-tuning. I'm very, very happy that this does enable us to meet our legal responsibilities the appropriate act. I just point out to Tom Anderson, who talked about, when he had this debate 6 years ago. In those 6 years, authorities up and down the country have been closing libraries. Yeah. Up and down the country, including Council, and moratory authorities. Yeah. So, I won't be lectured by the Tories about closing libraries. The reality is, if you look at the surveys, 54% of the respondents agreed with the original option of cutting to 411,000. In fact, we've listened to people and we said we'll halve that cut. But actually, the response to your complaint is don't make the cuts. Don't make your government in our budget. We will have to reduce ours. So the reality is, Mr. Mayor, I believe we've done the best job that we can with our principles of protecting frontline services. The opposition tonight are clearly intellectually bankrupt. They've not come forward one single alternative idea. Their amendments and their opposition should be treated with the contempt that they deserve. I ask Council to support the Labour motion. Thank you.
Okay.
spending and the other two of the HR.
Does that buy in favour with everyone in the authority? Would you like to have our votes on that?
Yes.
Okay, all those in favour, please show. Those against? Just recall that my abstention. 56-6 with one abstention. Okay, so we will have guillotine at 8 o'clock. Okay. That moves us on now to, we're now dealing with 6A, Roman numeral 2. Is that right? Yeah. All those, this is the Council's Act base, obviously, dedicated by the people's vote. All those in favour of the recommendation, please show. Oh, sorry. Can I have the movement second, which will be fulfilled? sorry, apologies. And this is the council tax base being set, so all those in favour, please show. Okay. And those against? And any abstentions? Well, yeah, you've got part of that, that's six.
petition. There's one to be debated, and that is in the name of Councillor Green. The other has been referred to the Constitutional Oversight Committee. So may I now have a poll proposer and seconder?
So
okay. I call on Councillor Green to move his motion.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I am conscious that to meet with it before the good if the Labour Party wants in a while actually acknowledge what has actually been done. And again, of course, more children in outstanding schools, which I think is fantastic news for all of us. Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, I believe that it's really important that we, in terms of the context, when we see what we were actually given as a government to pick up and take forward, to actually acknowledge the huge strides that we've made. The UK is now, as I understand it, the fastest growing economy in the G7 at 3.5%. There are countries, we talk about the French and Mr. Hollande and all the rest of it, where he followed, where we were told to follow his lead by Mr. Miliband. And of course, France is absolutely stuck without growth and with real social problems. So, Mr. Mayor, I just believe that in terms of balance, in terms of the debates that we have in this place, I think we would all get a greater degree of recognition from the electorate and some greater engagement with the electorate that from time to time, if we acknowledge when the government is doing the right thing or when the administration is doing the right thing, try to acknowledge when the administration is doing the right thing. I do wish they themselves would reciprocate and acknowledge when the government is doing the right thing. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Response 8 o'clock. You've done very well there. My fast finishing post. So I'll ask Councillor Rennie to formally second. No. That's our understandability. My other friends. Oh, seconders can speak. Okay. You can speak now. No problem.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. clearly lost 38-24 with one extension. Okay? Now move on to the final item before the AOB, as I mentioned earlier. Vacancies under 11, we need to appoint deputies. Will WIPS provide those to the officers of the safeguard group? Okay, the other AOB, the AOB, I think, would be remiss of us not to mention that this is Graham Burgess, our chief executive. Last full council meeting, I think his official retirement date is the 24th of December. Oh, 31st of December, but obviously, even he gets Christmas Eve, wasn't it? So, going through the 2.5 years, but before that, of course, so before that, Graham was an ally and friend of ours in many respects, certainly. Well, I've met him in the past before he became our chief exec. Also, he did join the improvement board to help turn the council around, hopefully, and he was part of that. So, I think you've seen what he liked. You like what you see, and became our permanent chief executive for 2.5 years. So I'd just like for us to, in a time honoured fashion, to say a huge thank you and a huge round of applause. Many of you, the board speakers, want to speak. I'll add that before we have a round of applause and allow Graham to speak.
Can I just associate my group with your remarks, Mr. Mayor? Clearly, when Graham came on chief executive in 2012, we were all considered difficult place. We all know the history of our issues with the group, as you say, in place. Greg came, like with a very good track record as an experienced chief exec, and moved this council forward, in terms of our governance challenges, to an extent that we, that the improvement board disengaged last March, and I think we're all is generally regarded as a good example of sector-led improvement. So I thank Greg for that. I think in line, I've been shortlisted for a number of awards for the Chronicle Awards in London, which again, I think is a credit to the team that worked with Greg. And at City Region, that comes down to a personal view. I do think we are now punching our weight. We clearly chair the combined authority, which has been set up in April, and we are leading the place now for creating the evolution to the City Region, and that's a huge tribute to the work that Graham has done at City Region. So I would like to call my thanks to Graham for his efforts on behalf of Wirral. I know you've got other projects in mind in your retirement, but I'd just like to thank you for your service with Wirral and wish you all the best for the future. Thank you.
Of a grateful council or grateful popular
decisions we had avoided, we were helped through that. In particular, I remember going to a very early cabinet meeting held in the hall, and we all have to have a sense of humour, but when some wise souls shouted, "How's the shower?" Mr. Burgess smiled and managed to carry on with the business. But thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Mr. Burgess. Mr. Mayor mentioned that the council hopefully would have gone. That is, I think, where we are. There was an interesting press article where I think the chief executive was quoted as just having won the war. Fortunately, I think we put our heads above the parapet and we're still gently creeping towards no man's land. But as it's Christmas, only a few of us are capable of playing football. So thank you for your service, Mr. Burgess.
Finally, thank you. council and the people of Wirral for the contribution you've made. It's not easy, the position of chief exec or leadership, certainly Phil Gilchrist, council agreed, Phil Davis have experienced that on a daily basis. I think the difficulty for any officer, particularly the chief exec, is very difficult for them to defend themselves in public, and in many respects they rely on the authority members to portray a good and positive image of the authority. My recommend is full councillors getting better, certainly been easier to chair than some councils of previous years. I think there is a change, and as part of that culture change, can I, as mayor, invite you to join with the officers of the council who put long hours in, particularly the committee staff, to enjoy a glass of festive cheer in the round room. And I wish you all a very merry Christmas and a prosperous